Welcome to our roundtable, 100% ESG, Challenges and Perspectives. My name is Ghislain Périsset. I am an ESG asset management and insurance expert. I'm pleased to animate this very interesting discussion with the PRI and the teams of the CCR and the CCRA. Our speakers today are Anaïg Antoine, head of PRI in France, Vincent Gros, General Counsel at CCR, David Moncoulon, Head of Modeling, Sébastien Jaillet, Chief Investment Officer, and Melissa Paxton, Vice President PNC Canada at CCR RE. The discussion of today will be about how an insurer, a reinsurer, the CCR and CCRA, is dealing with all these ESG challenges. So to start this very interesting discussion, we are going to have Anaïg from the PRI to explain us what are the requirements and what are the PRIs. Please, Anaïg.
Thank you, Ghislain. So the PRIs are the Principle for Responsible Investment. It's an international network of investors, and they represent $121 billion of asset under management. It was created in 2006 within the United Nations by Kofi Annan and a group of asset owners, including some French ones like Caisse des Dépôts, ERAFP, or FRR. The project of the PRI is to transform the financial system and to make it more sustainable, and also to encourage public authorities to promote this transformation. You can see here our six principles, and they refer to, it was the previous slide. Yes, thank you. So on our six principles, you can see that the investors commit to integrate ESG issues in all the asset classes. They also commit to be active investors. That is to say, they have to practice dialogue and voting with their investees and issuers. They also commit to reports on their activities, and this reporting is made public on our website afterwards. They also commit finally to share their good practices with their peers. On the next slide, you can see, that we have more now than 4,300 PRI signatories in the world, and we are supporting them to integrate ESG issues into their investment decision. We have, as signatory, we have asset owners, so insurers, pension funds, mutual insurance company, etc. We also have asset managers and service providers. In France, we have 360 signatories, including almost all major French asset owners. And we estimate that we have approximately more than 70% of assets under management in France. On the next slide, you can see all the investors all over the world. And to note that France is the third country in terms of number of signatories. But we also have signatories in many different countries where legislation and markets are not as advanced as in France. And this is maybe our biggest challenge, as we have to welcome investors that are at the beginning of their responsible investment practices. But also we have to welcome investors that are at much more advanced stages. So our vocation is to help everyone move forward, whatever their level of maturity on ESG. And we have tools and services for everyone to ensure that once investors have joined us, they take action and they do not rest on the fact that they have signed the PRI. So it's a complex challenge.
So what do the investors commit to when they join the PRI? What do they have to do exactly?
Yeah, that's a good question. Thank you. So when they join the PRI, it's normally like a first step in the launch of a responsible investment approach. It's a first stone that marks a public commitment and a willingness. But of course, everything remains to be done afterwards, such as defining ESG policies, setting up investment and ESG analysis processes. They also can participate to collaborative engagement. They have to publish objectives, monitor them, train teams. So a lot of stuff to be done afterwards. And in terms of commitments, from the second year of memberships, our members have to fill a very detailed questionnaire, which is then made public on our website. And this exercise is a guarantee of transparency on practices, and it's also here to encourage investors to improve on ESG. In the reporting, the investors have to detail the processes they have to put in place to integrate ESG in all the asset classes, and that is quite important to apply these ESG processes to all asset classes. They also have to detail their climate governance, their strategy and objectives on climate. And a novelty that we just introduced is the tracking of the results of their investment in the real world. And it is an increasingly important issue for us. And after this exercise of reporting, we assess the investors relatively to their peers, and we give them a scores. And that is a way for them to see how they position compared to their peers, and also to see where they can improve. And what we do with this course also is that we encourage asset owners to ask their scores to asset managers to select their next asset managers. And maybe to finish on this question of commitments, we have put in place some minimum criteria to be sure that when they join the PRI, the investors have basic measures they put in place on responsible investments. So maybe this minimum criteria will be strengthened in the coming years as we see that the practices become more and more mature, and to avoid also the greenwashing.
Yeah, your approach is increasingly impacting the full financial industry. Obviously, the insurer and reinsurer are a part of. What are the major trends you see, you identify?
We identify a lot of issues, but maybe today I will focus on one of them, which is climate change, obviously. And I know that is a particularly important topic for CCR. And I'm very glad that the CCR have joined the PRI, as they be able to share their team's expertise with or their peers in the PRI. So yeah, it's a very important issue, obviously, as we are not on track to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees. We know it already. And what we do at the PRI is that we work closely with investors to encourage them to implement ambitious climate action plan. As for example, we encourage them to establish net zero commitments. So it's something very important for us to set this commitment and short-term objectives. For that, we have set up the Net Zero Asset Owner Alliance with our partners from the UNEP-FI. And the Secretary General of United Nations called this alliance the Golden Standards on Climate. So it's a really, really good initiative. It was joined already by 69 asset owners, 30 of them already published targets. And yeah, it's a really good standard to set objectives. What we do also encourage our investors to do is to implement engagement action. For example, to dialogue and vote with their issuers. And for this, there is this collaborative engagement, which is called Climate Action 100+. It's an initiative where more than 600 investors dialogue with the most emissive companies in the world, and they ask them to set up midterm objectives on climate and to reduce their GHG emission. So it's a great initiative to join too. And to finish on climate, I would say also that it's important that investors begin to engage with their governments and to ensure that these governments set up climate policies that allow the investors to set up their own policies afterwards. So yeah, maybe I will stop here because it's already a lot, but if you have any questions, please let me know.
Thank you very much, Anaïg. Effectively, climate is at the heart of the PRI. It's also at the heart of the CCR. As you mentioned, the PRI was created also by French state-owned companies like CDC, FFR, ERAFP, and CCR alike is a PRI signatory. The CCR is really born within a strong governance process, of the French state to tackle natural disasters. So environment is at the heart of the CCR. And also at the heart, there is the impact, the positive impact on the society. So really the E, the S, and the G. So Vincent, could you kindly elaborate this genesis of the CCR and how the CCR could be seen as a 100% ESG company already for 75 years?
Well, thank you, Guylain. That's a very interesting question. As CCR, being a state-owned company, a state-owned group, was precisely incorporated in 1946 under the new French fundamental law at that time, and specifically to cover as the population against the natural disasters and ensure national solidarity. And this scheme was reinstated in 1982 by a law that was passed by the parliament. CCR, as a group, operates as a reinsurer and as an institutional investor in two major fields. First of all, in a non-competitive landscape, CCR provides covers against uninsurable risks such as natural disasters or terrorist attacks for material damages. As we all appreciate, insurance does not cover against systemic risks. The market can pay for the risk of a few with the premiums of many. But cannot cover an extreme event which would impact all the population at the same time. And that is precisely why the state provides the financial support to the private sector, to the financial, to the insurance companies, to complement their capacity. In the competitive market, on the other hand, CCR subsidiary, CCR RE, offers reinsurance services in property and casualty, life and health, as well as in several specialty lines in France and in 70 countries around the globe. So this very unique combination makes CCR a very specific player in a reinsurance world, which must systematically cover the risk weighting on its financial balance sheet through the amount provision and in the event of natural catastrophe or in the event of a natural disaster, which cannot be ruled out, which is a major constraint. And as by the way, this explains why CCR developed its R&D activities under the leadership of David over the last few years. So this set of constraints led it to put in place a very responsible strategy for the assessment of risk related to natural catastrophes, whose typology and whose intensity have worsened in the context of climate change. And David will come back to this with prospective view later on. All in all, the group is fairly advanced in implementing this risk integration strategy on both its investment strategy on the asset side under the leadership of Sébastien, and on its reinsurance underwriting policy on the liability side. And Melissa will come back to this regarding CCRE. And I will end up with that. In so doing, CCR Group complies with the following three principles. First and foremost, the solidarity, and thanks to the public reinsurance cover, CCR first gives companies and individuals a protection against natural disasters and therefore an access to an affordable coverage for exceptional events, which of course, help to maintain the resilience of the French economy, and finally, maintain solidarity against the various territories of the French Republic, whether we are considering mainland France or its overseas departments. Second principle is the prevention and reinsurance of physical risk, and CCR is a leading player in the scientific field of the study and management of physical risk linked to natural catastrophes. And the principle of solidarity finally produces some positive externalities in terms of societal support, so which is a big S of the ESG, and maintains, CCR helps the market to maintain an affordable insurance offer throughout France, and including its most vulnerable territories. That's all in all what CCR is here for.
Thank you, Vincent. It's very interesting to understand that the CCR at the heart of identifying climate risk and to try to deal with this risk, with the prevention part, with the investment. So I suggest that we start by understanding how you are studying the climate risk. And we are very happy so to have David Moncolon, who is in charge of the modeling. And I think we want to understand how you model that. What does it mean for France? What can it mean for other territories? Please, David, elaborate.
Thank you. So as Vincent said, we have a central role in the reinsurance of natural disasters. And that's why we have been developing since more than 15 years, the impact models to in order to measure the damages that come from natural hazards. For example, in this last year, we were modeling the many floods, the Irma cyclone, for example, and some seismic events. But one of the questions that we have to answer is what will be the impact of climate change on this natural hazard, and then on the damage incurred within the framework of the natural disasters scheme, and also for clients and for the state. So we develop impact models at very low resolution. For example, we have a resolution of 25 meters all over the French territory. As we can see on these maps, for floods, for marine submersions, cyclonic winds, and drought. We have a partnership with Météo France, and Météo France provides us with climatic modeling of what will be the climate and the natural events in 30 years. So we work on the 2050 horizon, which is not too far and not too close to be able to have a conclusion or some answers on climate change, but not too far to be able to project the insured value in the future. And we take these outputs from ARPEGE Climate, from Météo France, and we integrate them in our impact models in order to map what will be the exposure of natural disasters in the future. As we can see here in blue, it's the current exposure to flood, for example, and in yellow, the future exposure. And we can see that some part of the territories and some risk may not be exposed today, but will be exposed in the future if you take into account the climate change. And so that's important for us to have a global view on the insured portfolio and also non-insured portfolios, and what will be their exposure in the future. So, for example, in the middle map on this slide, you can see the ocean at Atlantic coast in Châtelaillon, donc in the zone that were exposed to the Xynthia storm in 2010. And the blue lines on this map is what have been surge during Xynthia 10 years ago. And in yellow or orange, you can see what will be surged by water if the same storm occurs with 23 centimeters of sea level rise. These 23 centimeters are what we expect with the RCP 8.5 scenario from the IPCC. And it's a pessimistic scenario, but that is still realistic. At the French scale, we have some figures on this slide, and we can see that if For example, today the CCR covers every year 1 billion euros of annual damages due to natural disasters. We expect an increase of these annual damages by 50% in 2050. And this 50% are for two-thirds due to hazard increase, and for one-third due to the increase of population and insured value in the future exposed area. So we can work on this this increase of population in the exposed area by working with the Ministry of Ecology and providing them with some results of our models, for example, the maps that we have seen before, that allow them to have a specific prevention politic on the local territories, taking into account what will be the risk in the future. And so that's an important activity for us and for the equilibrium of the scheme, of the natural disaster scheme in the future. So the next slide, we can see that these results at the French territory scale are not the same depending on the region on which we are working. For example, we have a more important increase of damage on the Atlantic coast due especially to the increase of seawater level in the future. We also have an increase of 30% that can appear low on the Mediterranean area, but in fact, it's applied on very high damage, so it's less important in terms of increase, but the Mediterranean area is still the most exposed in terms of damage to natural disasters. We have also worked on the overseas territory, and our studies allow them to simulate an increase of 20% of annual damages in the Guadeloupe and in the other overseas territory, and especially due to the increase of not the frequency, but the intensity of cyclones. And the next slide is another study that we've made financed by the World Bank, and we have worked for the insurers in Morocco, and the idea was to develop the same approach of modeling, combining a global climatic model with impact model for flood, and simulate what will be the exposed area in Morocco in the future. And this work have been done with a newly created fund that is here to pay for the damage for the non-insured people in Morocco. So this is for us important to use our methods in other countries, working with, for example, the World Bank here. And we have also in France, we are working with the French electricity network to assess the exposure of the electric lines to climate change and work with them to ensure that they are resiliency in the future.
Yeah, your work is really great. If all the countries of the world will have such kind of reinsurer with such kind of data and societal approach, it will be really helpful not only to the politicians, but to politics, but also to the investors. Yeah. So really, it will have a huge impact. And I understand that the model that you have developed is currently being used also by regulators. So, Vincent, well, how does it work? What the regulators, the French regulators, the ACPR, and certainly the EIOPA, are doing those kind of models?
Well, thank you, Guylain. I would like first to pay tribute to the Banque de France and ACPR, which took the lead on all the climate change impact calibration and model, among other central banks. And the first climate pilot exercise that was conducted by the ACPR, which stands for Autorité de Contrôle Prudentiel et de Résolution, is unprecedented and ambitious. It was the first time that really prudential supervisors organized a comprehensive climate change risk assessment exercise with 9 prominent banking groups and 15 major insurance companies under its supervision. Its ambitious aim lies with the time frame over which the risks were assessed, that is to say 30 years ahead of us, so by 2050. The methodology that was used, and the coverage of both physical and transition risks. The aim of this exercise was first to raise the awareness of financial groups, staff, of climate change issues and impacts. And of course, beyond that, also to measure, to quantify the exposure of financial groups to climate change risks using economic scenarios inspired by the NGFS and by Banque de France. As an expert in modeling physical risk, i.e. natural disasters, CCR was tasked by the supervisory authority to measure the impact of climate change on the insurance portfolios of the insurers group, which we did in three ways. First, CCR set up a specific modeling chain based on long-standing climate change modeling and at the same time generated exposure maps at a town level and also produced other indicators. Second, CCR provided insurers with an estimation of the insured losses of their portfolios resulting from the peril impacted by climate change, that is to say floods, coastal flooding, droughts, as well as cyclones. And third, CCR also integrated the evolution of the hazards and as well as the distribution of both the population and its activities and businesses from now up until 2015. And the outcome of which is this pilot exercise reveals an overall moderate exposure of French banks and insurance companies to climate change risk, which is positive. Having said that, however, this conclusion must be put in the perspective of climate change dynamics, and especially its speed and the evolution of its impacts. And it is also dependent on the assumptions that were taken at the time it was conceived, if I may say. David just spoke about the, let's say, the sinistrality and claims. This exercise also raises the importance of and the seriousness of all the prevention efforts of all the stakeholders in the years to come, and the studies of David and his team can help to measure also the sensibility of the prevention efforts and investments and their impacts on possible natural disaster scenario, and thus to quantify their interest and their benefits for the society as a whole. And this is with these positive outcomes that I will conclude on that.
I'm really thrilled by the level of knowledge on climate risk that your company has. It's incredible, and I suppose that the people, the person who are today listening, are learning a lot, and you are using that for prevention, you are using that for the central bank, for all the European financial community to understand the impact. I'm pretty sure that your investment function is using that as well for the investment. So, Sébastien, could you let us know what you are doing with this kind of information? What is your framework of investment?
Yes, thank you, Gina. First of all, I think that the pandemic has increased concerns about climate, biodiversity, and social issues. And we see these risks as an investment risk for our own portfolios as well. So I think that CCR Group is convinced that taking into account the ESG criteria has a positive impact on the risk-adjusted performance of our investments. So just for an introduction, concerning the what we did on the last 2 years on the investment side, we built an ESG philosophy around three pillars. So two pillars regarding the climate risk, I mean transition risk prevention and adaptation to the physical risks. And the third one concerning the non-related climate ESG issues. So principally the transition, the societal transition support. Mm-hmm. We talked about previously. So regarding the first pillar, the transition risk prevention, we aim to find, we analyze the contribution of the portfolio to the Paris Agreement targets, measuring carbon footprint extended to scope 3, what we did last year, and temperatures of our portfolios, increasing green bond investments globally as a contribution to this transition. First of all, on the first pillar, what we did is the formal coal policy with a commitment to a full exit in 2030. So the second pillar we talked about and David showed, we took our own capabilities concerning the physical risk assets in terms of modelization in order to measure the directly owned real asset portfolio. And that's what we do with a proprietary CCR tool we developed last year. And perhaps David could tell us a little bit more about what we did concerning our own headquarters, the headquarters of CCR Group, to illustrate the...
Yes, this is an example of using our modeling tool and our website tools to study the exposure of specific risk. As you can see here, it's the address of the headquarters of CCR Group. And we compared them here with modeling of the flood of the Seine River, and we can see that our headquarters are outside the flood area, the footprint area of the Seine River in Paris, but not that far, in fact. And if we change this map and for the next one, we can see here the exposure of pluvial flood in the same area. And as we can see here, the headquarters of CCR are concerned by pluvial flood. So that's an important issue. And of course, We have alerted our headquarters, and the idea is to avoid the underground goods in CCR.
Now that's great. So it means that you are really using all your model to estimate all the climatic risk handover by your full book.
Exactly.
Wow, that's great. So
that's a very good illustration. Thank you, David. Globally, we talk about the contribution to the pilot exercise for the ACPR for the physical assets. And globally, the third pillar is the wider one for the investments. I mean, is the global ESG risk improvement in our portfolios. I mean, investment in as well in social or sustainable bonds. But globally, this is several aspects, and we aim to improve in the next few years.
So you have set up a framework. You are using the tools. I see that you are very pragmatic in the way you handle that. What does it mean in terms of investment decision? Because you need to invest year after year. What are you doing today?
So first of all, I would say that we have to improve our ESG policy and to be aligned with our own commitments and our vision about the climate risk, but globally the ESG risk, and we aim to take some commitments at the CCR Group level, and these commitments will be implemented in the investment guidelines as a risk guidelines. So the investment universe will have to comply with both financial and non-financial guidelines. So I think this is important concerning globally what we are doing on the investment side. This is the first point. And the second point, I would say that we have to improve each year our own commitments. So we will have to deal with the hydrocarbon and the biodiversity on the next ESG report we are doing for the 2021 exercise. This is the first point. And what we did and what we aim to improve as well is the ESG policy to external asset managers. So as you know, we delegate some assets to external asset managers, and it's very important for us to understand, to monitor what they do with the funds we delegate to these external asset managers. And what we did at the end of 2021 is that we sent surveys on the ESG policy, both on the asset manager, but as well on all the funds we hold with these asset managers, in order to understand well what they are doing, and to be able to challenge their ESG policy in the next future. So I think this is very important for us as well, to be able to do that, and that's what we do. Perhaps we can show some illustration on what we did last year on the concerning the carbon footprint. So the carbon efficiency of our group aims to be lower than globally the investment universe, and what we can see on the chart, perhaps we can show, is that with the carbon footprint, both for CCR Group, CCR or CCRE, is better than globally the benchmarks for iBox or MSCI, for example, index. And we could as well compare our carbon footprint, for example, on the corporate bonds or sovereign bonds, compared to several benchmarks. Concerning the real estate assets, we have commitments to reduce the consumption of our real estate assets. And if we hold both residential and commercial real assets, and we reduced the consumption on 2020 compared to 1 year before. So globally, and we hope we will be able to reduce more the consumption in the future.
That's really great. So you show that you have already been implementing this ESG policy. Here it's very visible on everything linked to carbon efficiency, energy consumption. Could you show as well perhaps an example of opportunity you are dealing with where there is a real asset impact, something that is very green?
I think we see the ESG and the climate change as a risk, but it's as well, as you say, Justin, an opportunity for investments. And we worked last year on this opportunity in order to increase our assets on infrastructure fund with an impact fund, so SFDR 9, and contributing to the energy transition. So we will make an investment of 1% of our asset under management on a specific infrastructure fund dedicated to the hydrogen technology, which will contribute to the Paris-aligned benchmark, the targets.
But does it mean investing in green asset like that? Does it mean lower returns, or is it very interesting yet?
No, it's very interesting, around 15%. of return. This is very interesting, and this is as well interesting because, as you know, we have to think about higher inflation we can see today, and this this high inflation environment is very good for physical assets, mm-hmm. And at the same time, so an infrastructure fund contributing to the energy transition is very good for the ESG in terms of climate change, but as well for the return and as well in this high inflation environment today.
Mm. So that's great. Green assets are an inflation edge. They allow to have a societal positive impact. I'm pretty sure that Anaïg may have some question to you, Sébastien, because at the PRI investment are the art. So what are your questions, Anaïg, to Sébastien?
Yeah, thank you, Ghislain. I was particularly interested by many things that David, Vincent and Sébastien said. I find that CCR's modeling capability and also climate knowledge is really impressive. And also the societal mission of the CCR is a very interesting issue, as we see that social issues are increasingly important topic for investors, and especially with the need of a just transition that we feel more and more everywhere. But maybe to open the discussion today, I will focus on what Sébastien said about the way CCR challenges its asset managers on ESG, because it's something that at the PRI we encourage asset owners to do, as we think that the asset owners are at the top of the financial system and that they need to use their influence on asset managers to make them improve on ESG at different levels. So maybe, Sébastien, could you share with us, how do you challenge your asset managers? What do you ask from them? And also, did you notice any changes on the way your asset managers respond to your requests on ESG?
Thank you, Anaïg. So this is a very good question. I think this is very important because it's the difference between communication and realization on the ESG issues. And concerning the question, the first one is, are you signatory of PRI? I think this is the first one. But concerning the other questions, I think we have a lot of questions regarding their thermal coal policy, their ESG approach concerning different aspects. I think we aim to quantify in order to be able to challenge as well and to see and to rank different asset managers on the ESG side in order to be able to appreciate the level of the and the quality of the ESG policy on the investment policy, included in the investment policy of each asset manager and on each fund we hold. So globally, I think this is very important to make the distinction between what they do with our
what own they say, what they really do
fund, with our own money and what they communicate. So we aim to be able to measure that.
Anaïg, would you have any other question to Sébastien?
Oh, maybe if we have time, I would be interested to understand more about the societal mission of the CCR and how do you include social issues into your investment processes?
So the social issues is a wide range. We aim to be able to show the improvement of each ESG score concerning each ESG fund we hold regarding different aspects. So it's very wide question. But globally, we try to better understand. I think each ESG policy of each asset manager is different, with a different approach. It's not a dogmatic approach. It's the first step is to be able to understand well and to quantify, and we will see afterwards what we do.
Yeah, transparency and look through is the very first step, and be pragmatic. As you mentioned, different asset manager, different asset owner, different countries, different culture on social, different culture on vision on what is good for the climate or not. Thank you very much, Sébastien. It was indeed very interesting. And what is being done on the investment side? You may have a similar approach on the underwriting side. Melissa, we are going to be very interested to see how, on the underwriting side, when you discuss with a client of CCRA, how you are dealing with all this ESG topic. What is your logic today? How do you manage the ESG challenging on your side?
Thank you, Gisele. CCRA recognizes that there's a need for action now to meet the milestone of 2030 and to meet the 2050 net zero emission target, and that we need to do our part. Our ultimate goal in our underwriting ESG journey is to deploy actionable guidelines for our frontline reinsurance underwriting group, because there's no question about it. We as an industry need to do our part in coming up with solutions. We're very conscious of the falsities of grand gesture statements that could lead to greenwashing, for example, signing on to different initiatives to drive a PR boost with no concrete actions related to it. We want to deliver on promises that we make. We are therefore considering a deliberate and thoughtful approach to the issues. With the addition of an ESG analyst to our ranks, we've formed an underwriting task force to review the framework of our existing book of business and the impact of various changes to our guidelines when it comes to all things ESG, and to understand the best way to enforce them. It's with this in mind that we're welcoming being a new member of the signatory of the Young PRI, and we also welcome NAIDS input.
It's that you have a pragmatic approach, and you start with the point that around there is a lot of people speaking, a lot of public relationship type of way of doing. So in practice, what steps are you concretely wise taken so far?
So we recognize that there's the first step to meaningful change in our underwriting will be a thorough understanding of our book of business. And in turn, this will require a deep understanding of our clients' book of business and transparency and collaboration on the subject. The main challenge we face is we don't always have the knowledge of who is ultimately insured in any book of business and what is being presented to us. So far, we've completed a first analysis of our portfolio to understand our exposure to coal, thermal, and metallurgical across all of our business units. We understand that there's certainly a need for further analysis.
Yeah, obviously for you, it's a new challenge. Huh? The insurer are your clients. You have an ESG policy at your CCR level. So what is your impact in the relationship with your client? How are you dealing with them on that?
Well, we value and respect the partnership that we've established over the years with our clients, and we're conscious that our actions will have an impact on the business that we subscribe to in the future. Our vision concerning ESG may not always align with our clients. It's our responsibility to understand and navigate the topic. We anticipate some potentially difficult but open and constructive conversations with all of our clients. We recognize that a broad paintbrush approach to changing our underwriting guidelines would not be appropriate, as we have clients across all regions of the world. We need to have an awareness of our clients' business when it comes to ESG. Understanding the differences between territories is very important. Some are more dependent, for example, on thermal coal, having no other economically viable alternative to electricity. And in some jurisdictions, it's not possible to exclude some types of risks or some industries. Even the idea of excluding potential coverage for some specific industries with little to no viable greener alternative available currently, like cement or steel, is posing some roadblocks.
Yeah, I perfectly understand you, Melissa. On the investment side, I've been coordinating some European working group with all insurers and asset managers. I can say to you that in France, for example, it will be full exclusion of coal. In Germany, they start excluding when the company is doing more than 30%, but they exclude every country having nuclear weapons. So we see the differences of culture and underwriting side must be even more important. What are your next steps? What are you doing really to start this journey with your clients?
So first, it's a deep dive. So it's internal. It's a further analysis of our global book of business to highlight our potential exposures to both environmental and social societal exposures. It's required. This should and will be followed with conversations and learning. So over the last year, we've encouraged our underwriters to have a first conversations with our various clients, asking plainly if they have an ESG initiative. We'll continue to drive that conversation. To illustrate some of the responses we've had so far, we've received a wide range of responses from very developed and robust programs on both the active and passive side of the issue to some having no initiatives in place, no plans in the short term to start any, or even a clear understanding of what ESG stands for, which is confusing it with the impact of natural disaster on their book of business. We're also we'll be providing pertinent information to our underwriting colleagues on ESG topics so we can have meaningful conversations. Some of the table topics of conversations with our clients will revolve around what is their current ESG awareness and ambitions, what constraints are they facing in applying them on a go-forward basis, what type of timelines are they expecting this change to take place, are there any of their clients amongst the identified major carbon list companies, what is their opinion on what's achievable by the industry in the short and medium term? And lastly, collaboration. I certainly hope that we see more collaboration on the underwriting side of ESG, as we've seen on other subjects like cyber underwriting, where there are a number of working groups and conferences for underwriters and experts to meet. And remembering that being in your own echo chamber does not normally yield good results.
Ah, thank you very much, Melissa. So from what you describe, I understand what is a common point between underwriting and investment is about transparency, look-through, pragmatism, questioning more either your provider on the investment side or the client on the underwriting, fact-checking attitude. What does it mean now in 10 years, 20 years, 25 years? You go really in a deep dive, constant questioning. So I think it's a strong meiotic to try to dig among all these topics. So that has been a great discussion with all of you. We have learned a lot around the PRI, the CCR. The CCR is truly a 100% ESG company for long. You didn't know you were that ESG, but Anaïk says that it was impressive, and also I have been impressed, and I hope that all the listener of today would have appreciated and will come back to all of you with a lot of questions. Your climate risk model, your societal impact, your logic on investment, on underwriting, I think are going to be very interesting for everybody. Thank you to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.